Good morning everyone. So today is 26 May 2020 and the heat wave conditions in India is intensifying all over the northern states of India, and the mercury is breaching the 46 degree mark in various places including the national capital. So coming to the article portion, let's begin the editorial. So the first article here is early takeoff. So this article is about the decision of the central government to resume the domestic flight and the difficulties and problems associated with the relaunching of the domestic flights in India. So some chief ministers, notably of Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu, have expressed apprehensions about a premature resumption of civil aviation. As the COVID-19 cases are still on rise, it is unrelenting and quarantine monitoring has its limit. And because you cannot monitor thousands of passengers which are coming through flights as well as through trains and put them in quarantine and take utmost care of them. So this has been a very troublesome thing for the states, and states are expressing dissatisfaction on the fact that center is resuming the domestic flights. The experience of flight cancellation, passenger frustration and low capacity among the states to track thousands of passengers should prompt a rethink on scheduling flights. So here the editor is saying that along with the decision to resume the flight, the passengers are facing a lot of problem. The flights are cancelling. They do not have the proper guideline about the quarantine facilities and the period of the quarantine. So they are going through a period of confusion. And emergency air travel has always been a necessity in the time of calamity. So it is going to be there. Those who are entrapped at various places and they want to go back to their homes, that is required. The states should develop that capacity to handle those passengers. But opening the domestic flight and trains altogether without any proper monitoring would lead to a chaos, can lead to surge in the COVID-19 cases also. So the risk associated with domestic aviation have multiplied due to early missteps in several states. So various mass gatherings had took place, political events and consumer crowding for panic buying have resulted in major transmission clusters. So there are major few months back, only a 1.5 months back, we did not have any transmission cluster. The community transmission had not started, but now the situation has changed and we have so many clusters within India which can be termed as transmission cluster, and migration of people from there can lead to surge in COVID-19 cases to the places where it is not still found. So states which have denied the presence of community transmission want to reduce the pace at which they must monitor newly arriving individuals. So they want to monitor the individuals first, and this requires a lot of capacity building. So for this, the states are saying that they need time for this thing, and we should not hurry, we should not take early steps in this thing. Enabling scheduled travel through national policy, whether by air or rail, could be seen as a reasonable effort only when state governments are fully prepared. So any resumption of flight should be taken only when the state governments are fully prepared to tackle such huge issue. And also, in earlier articles also, we have discussed to adopt a uniform code of practice at various places in Bengaluru, in Uttar Pradesh, Bihar. The norms of quarantine are different, and the passengers are not made aware of the norms of the receiving state, and because of which they are facing confusion. There's a need to adopt a uniform code of practice. So within the lockdown, the virus crisis has snowballed only in states such as Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu and Gujarat and Delhi. But that picture could change with the operation of daily flights. So those states which have less number of COVID cases are saying that resumption of daily flights could lead to a surge in the cases there also. A couple of hundred scheduled trains from June 1 and the large number of promised Shramik special trains for migrant workers. So it is essential, therefore, for states to adopt a coordinated approach on quarantine and testing. Travel choices in the present phase should be designed to discourage optional journeys. So yes, freedom of movement and expression is a fundamental right, but this is the time of crisis and we have to understand that rights are abrogated at such exigencies. Moreover, passengers on all flights, including relief flights, could have a lower risk if airlines and the government keep the middle seats vacant. As decided on March 23 by the DGCA, there is no reason to think that the pandemic has begun to wane. The global aviation map shows that even market economies like USA, etc., they are placing great emphasis on individual freedoms, have severely limited travel. So those countries which have placed great emphasis on individual freedom are now exercising restrictions on travel, making exceptions only for returning citizens. So only in the cases where travel is necessary, the travel exemption should be given, and that too states and center should assist each other in monitoring the whole situation. The passengers should be kept in a strict quarantine. The COVID-19 pandemic has yet not waned and we should not act like this. The second article is battling for free speech. So here a case of Tamil Nadu has been discussed. So what is happening in Tamil Nadu? It's almost in the last three decades, there has been indiscriminate institution of criminal defamation proceedings against the opposition leaders and the media. So what is happening in Tamil Nadu, whoever criticizes the government faces the criminal defamation proceedings. So the Madras High Court, they come up with a comprehensive judgment on the limits of the state's power to prosecute members of the press. So here a verdict of Justice Abdul Kudhose has been discussed, where he has quashed a series of defamation complaints filed since 2011-12. So what he did, is remarkable, because he said that applying a set of principles that would firmly deter the hasty and ill-advised resort to state-funded prosecution on behalf of public servants. So the first principle is that the state should not impulsively invoke provisions in the criminal procedure code to get its public prosecutor to file defamation complaints in response to every report that contain criticism. So what is happening in Tamil Nadu? Criminal defamation complaints is filed for every report that contains criticism. So any report that is containing some sort of criticism of the government has to face criminal prosecution, and this is against the fundamental right to free speech. The court deems such impulsive actions as amounting to throttling democracy. So court is saying that this is against the fundamental principle of democracy. It advises the government to have a higher threshold for invoking defamation provisions. It notes that each time a public servant feels defamed by a press report, it does not automatically give rise to a cause for asking the public prosecutor to initiate proceedings on her behalf. So here the court has clarified that it's not necessary that every time whenever a public servant is criticized in a report or is criticized in media. It's not necessary that every time a public criminal defamation case is filed against that person. So free criticism of the government is a fundamental feature of democracy, and it should not be taken off from the citizen. The statutory distinction between defaming a public servant as a person and as the state itself being defamed has to be maintained. Also, Justice Cardozo goes on to fault the government for recording sanctions to the initiation of cases through the prosecutors without explaining how the state has been defamed. So here the state also Justice Cardozo said that before going to the court and filing a complaint against a person or a institution, the government should clarify whether it has been defamed or not, whether the word state has been used or not. He cautions prosecutors against acting like a post office, noting that their role is to scrutinize the material independently to see if the offense has been made out, and if so, whether it relates to a public servant's conduct in the course of discharging official functions or not before filing a complaint. So the court also put onus upon the public prosecutors also. He also said that the public prosecutors has a responsibility. They have a responsibility to file a complaint only after properly examining the situation. The court finds that many were cases in which public servants ought to have filed individual cases. An earlier Madras High Court ruling noted that an essential ingredient of criminal defamation must be that an imputation was actuated by malice or with reckless disregard for the truth. So if there is evidence that the report is filed on the basis of true facts, then how can a public servant can initiate a proceeding, and that too not against himself but on the basis of the whole system? So a recent judgment by Justice G.R. Swaminathan enunciated what is known in the United States as the Sullivan rule of actual malice. So he quashed a private complaint against a journalist and a newspaper. The judge said two of the exceptions to defamation given in section 499 pertain to public conduct of public servants and conduct of any person on any public question. This implied that the legislature itself believed that unless it is demonstrated that reporting on a public servant's conduct or on a public question was vitiated by malice, the question of defamation does not arise, and that even inaccuracies in reporting need not occasion a prosecution for defamation. So within a matter of days, the High Court has struck two blows for free speech and press freedom. So in the end to perorate, I can say that judiciary has once again proved that it is the guardian of the Constitution as well as the fundamental rights of the citizen. From its two judgments mentioned in the article, it has proved that democracy forms the basic structure of the Constitution, and under the normal circumstances, no wing of the government, say legislature, executive or the judiciary itself, has the right to snatch away the right to freedom of expression from the citizens.